Hi, everybody. My name is Adam B. Levine. I'm the editor-in-chief of Let's Talk Bitcoin, which is a show and blog, letstalkbitcoin.com. I'm the chief architect and user of the upcoming LTB coin user-created asset. I'm the chief visionary officer of a company called Humint.is, which is building custom cryptocurrencies for brands, causes, and all good things in the world. And also, I am an amateur in this space. I got involved with Bitcoin first about 3 years ago, and then about, I guess it was April 25th of last year, I made the jump, and I started working in the space full-time doing a media project called Let's Talk Bitcoin. It snowballed from there. So we've heard a couple of technical talks here, and I want to talk to you about users and humans and kind of how we work. Bootstrapping is an interesting word. It's the chicken-egg problem that you run into when you're trying to start something new. And it's hard because nobody understands what you're doing. Nobody wants to have anything to do with it. It's like Reddit is a great example of this. You look at how they started, and the procedure was, you know, Reddit is this, it's like taken over for Dig is like the center for user-based discussion and curation. And the way that they started was they had everybody they knew register an account, and they themselves, the founders, registered like dozens or hundreds of accounts, and they just talked to each other because nobody wants to join a community where there's nobody there. And so you have to sort of simulate, it's cheating in a certain way, but it solves the problem of having no activity mean there will never be any activity. So this is a problem that's hard to solve. How many people here have done a project before where you couldn't get past that first 1,000 user? Yeah? Okay, cool. So again, like this is a problem that Bitcoin faced early on, actually. You know, what essentially Bitcoin mining is, yes, it does transactions, yes, it does all these other things, but at its core, it's make work. It's work that doesn't actually, once you pass a certain point of power in the network, you can basically process all the transactions that are going through, and everything else is just sort of redundant security on top. This is why the difficulty is self-adjusting, is because in the beginning, when there's only a few people, actually it's incredibly valuable if you're mining. But as that moves on, not so much. Now, there are problems for mining, as Tim brought up, which notably is that there's only one block reward, right? 25 bitcoins every 10 minutes goes to one single address. So this has led to the concentration of pools, just like lottery pools are more effective than playing the lottery by yourself because you have a larger chance, and so it essentially flattens out the variance of your results. So this is a problem, like I said, that Bitcoin solved really well. They had this reward out there that they're paying no matter who's getting it, no matter who's doing the work, whatever comparable it is. And so what they wound up with is a situation that everybody's doing the work. And it's not tremendously efficient, but they're doing it. And it's make work. And again, you look at the ASIC industry. This is an entire industry of computers that are specialized to do make work. So again, and we've now, I was talking with a developer yesterday who's telling me that we are actually, we're down to 20 nanometers on all the mainline ASIC processors, which is the state of the art. And Intel is telling them they're gonna have to wait at least until 2016 to get down to 14 nanometers. So we actually have reached something of a plateau. I bring this up not because mining is great, but because mining solved the bootstrapping problem. Mining looked at the problem and it said, well, somebody's got to do it, so I guess we'll just pay whoever does it. And this is actually something that we can then take and we can essentially move on to other things with it. So I want to talk about bootstrapping a wishing well, right? Imagine that on your way to work, you pass one day a wishing well. It's a cool looking wishing well. You walk over to it and all you've got in your pocket, unfortunately, are these gold coins. I mean, so you're not an idiot. You're not going to throw in gold coins into a wishing well. I mean, it might be cool, might, you know, be something that you want to do, but you're not dumb, so a few people are going to do it because it's the wrong decision to make. But what if next to that wishing well, there was a token dispenser that was giving out free quarters, and it gives out 10 free quarters a day? It's right on your way to work, so there's no problem. You stop by, and you're the first one there, so you take all 10. And next day you come back, you throw a few in. Next day you come back, and there's another 10. So you start adding it to your, you make it a part of your routine, because you're getting something for nothing. And whereas the wishing well wasn't that valuable when, you were going to have to spend something that was valuable to you and it cost you to apply, in this case, it's free. It's a novelty and it costs you nothing. So now, this is not just appealing to you, of course. It's on other people's way to work, too. They eventually find it. And, for a second guy who shows up, that's 5 coins for each person per day. And you kind of move down this path. And at the point that you get to more than 10 people per day, you've got a market price for the coins. So it's an interesting thing because if nobody ever shows up there, if just that one person ever showed up and said, hey, well, I would do this except I'm not going to use a gold coin, then probably the wishing well would never succeed. But at that point, that it's a part of these people's routine, and they're being rewarded for it, and they have that expectation, suddenly there's a reason where before there wasn't. So mining, the mining reward in Bitcoin is all about solving that bootstrapping problem for Bitcoin. And what that kind of, this came to me a few months ago. What it means is that we don't have to solve the mining problem again. It's not perfect, what Bitcoin has done, but they've done well, and it's very powerful, and they have a lot of security in the network just because they solved that problem well. But what we can do using the metacurrencies that Vitalik was talking about is build on top of Bitcoin, leveraging all of the work that they've done, and then create new layers on top that are value layers, which isn't to say that, how do I say this? So using a protocol like MasterCoin or Counterparty, the process for creating a new crypto token is literally a 5-minute process. It's five minutes costs, you know, in MasterCoin, I'm not sure what it's gonna cost, I think about $100 right now based on current prices. In Counterparty right now, I think the price is about $5. Not sure which one is right. There are some spam problems once you get down to that low cost like Tim was mentioning, but it's interesting to see the variety of approaches. But the important part is that the most expensive that it is right now is $100. And it's a one-time fee to get the asset name. And then once you have the asset name, you can create as many coins as you want. And so again, this creates its own problem because Bitcoin is trusted, right? Bitcoin has the ability essentially to, you know, it's on this schedule and it's algorithmically encoded, so you don't really have to trust anybody. But these other layers, you kind of do because there's just the ability to press a button and create more. But what it means is that if you want to start something new, you don't have to create a new currency or a new blockchain or anything like that. All you have to do is take the existing options that are out there, create an asset that can serve your purposes, and then figure out what adds value to your network and distribute it to the people who are doing that on a schedule that you set and define. So I have 13 projects that I'm working on right now that are in this space, and I'm picking up more weekly at this point. You know, because these user-created assets are brand new. You couldn't do this 4 weeks ago. And you can't even really do it now. I have one of the first ones up. It's up on testnet right now. Again, Tim mentioned CounterWallet, testnet.counterwallet.co if you are interested in looking at what the options are right now, because it's pretty mind-boggling. What essentially these are the first multi-wallets, where you can have more than one cryptographic asset held in the same wallet on, under the control of the same address. So that means that instead of having for every new cryptocurrency you download, you have to download a new client, and it's like, you know, downloading essentially a new browser for this one particular type of currency. Now you don't have to do that. Now you can have thousands of currencies, and you can only see the ones that you want. You can filter them however you want. So as I mentioned, I have a lot of projects in this space. I'm going to go through three real quick, and then we're actually going to end because I'd like to get to questions. But I'm happy to answer any questions about these topics, as it is pretty much what I'm spending all my time doing. So three networks. One, CharityCoin. CharityCoin, the concept for adding value to CharityCoin is that when you donate to this particular charity, they give you back on a one-for-one basis, based on what the current market rate is, these new coins. And this can be done one of two ways. It can be done on a schedule. So like you could say every person... So that you could say 1,000 coins are created, 1,000 charity coins are created every week, and then based on how many people, how much people donate, it's distributed to them based on how much they donated over that period of time. And so you create this weighting. And so it means that, again, it's that bootstrapping thing. If nobody donates that week except for one person, they get all 1,000 coins. But if 1,000 people donate, they get one coin. So that actually is a really good reflection of reality because, again, support is most valuable when it is rare, when it is infrequent. The first fan, the 10th fan, is the most important fan, exponentially more important than the 100th, than the 1,000th, and the further up you go, the less valuable they are. So again, it's about that never having no activity, because the reason for there to be activity, you know, donation can actually become a selfish, you know, self-serving thing in this case, because you look opportunistically and you say, okay, well, I can actually make more money donating to this project than I would just keeping my money, because the market rate, you know, says this, and so that's, again, it can be profitable is the point. So then, of course, with those coins, anyone who accepts them is de facto accepting charity, even if they didn't buy them, that means that they effectively bought them, sorry, if they didn't get them directly from the charity, it means that they bought them from someone who did donate to the charity. And, you know, again, like if this was a mined blockchain, which I don't think it should be, but if it were, you could argue that every person who is mining this coin is mining again on behalf of charity, because this is how they are created, this is how they are distributed, this is the purpose that it serves. And it creates a really interesting, again, value metric that you can sort of start to go around on. So PermaCredits is another one. Permacredits is a marriage of permaculture and cryptocurrency, basically. And it is essentially a reinvention of Kickstarter. You're going to see a lot of these concepts coming out over the next probably 6 months, and they're really important because Kickstarter is great if you want the thing that they're selling. You know, if you want the reward and the price that you're willing to pay for it happens to match up with the thing that, you know, with the price that they think that it's worth. So if you instead take that system and say, okay, well, here are the prices denominated in dollars that we're going to charge for these things. Here are all the rewards we offer, same thing as always. But instead of giving people back just, you know, you have this reward, that's it. Instead, you make it tokens. You make it tokens, and the tokens themselves are deflationary. If you've ever watched a Kickstarter project, they're now actually starting to do this, where you can essentially have a reward that you can't get outside of the Kickstarter project. Like games are doing this a lot, you know, unique ships, things like that. Starfarer was one of the recent ones. And again, these things can sell for $500, $600. So they started making them recently tradable. So people who got in early and bought them in the Kickstarter now have the ability to sell that ship package that they bought because you can't get it any other way. But again, what if this was not about a ship? What if it was just about a token? And at the start, each token was worth a penny, but then because there's a fixed supply of them that is just created during this fundraising period, and then there's this 9 month or, you know, 18 month period where the project is being promoted and developed and becoming more. Again, a successful project should be far more popular and desirable when it is available than when it is first proposed. If it is less popular when it's available, then you have failed. And so again, there are a couple of things that this does. First, it means that you never have lock-in, right? You never have a situation where a project's going bad and you're like, well, that sucks. You know, I have nothing I can do about that. Instead, you just go to the market and you're like, well, sell these at, you know, 20% of what, you know, of what I would get back, but it's better than nothing. And someone who's willing to take the risk then can come in and say, okay, well, you know, that seems like a good deal to me. I think that, you know, I'm willing to take that risk. So again, it allows people to make choices about what it is that they want to do with their time, with their time and with their stake. And then the last thing that I want to talk about real quickly is LTB coin, which is my attempt at essentially reinventing the media model. I've been working on this in one form or another now for about 9 months. Because again, Let's Talk Bitcoin has always been a tips-driven enterprise. In the last 9 months or 10 months or however long it's been, we've received upwards of 4,000 tips in Bitcoin. And those tips are all deflationary, and it's worked really, really well for us. But an interesting thing happened on the way to $1,000. Even though our audience is exponentially bigger now, we still get the same amount of tips. And it's because it's valuable. You know, I mean, like when something's not valuable, it's okay to spend it. It's okay to give it away to people because it's not that valuable. But as things get more valuable, they become very serious. And so, you know, there's a currency out there called Dogecoin that has an interesting story behind it. But the bottom line is it's a meme coin. It's a coin that's essentially started off as a joke. But again, if money is about adoption, then a lot of people speak Doge right now. And so it's done very well. But the point is that there was a presentation at the Coin Summit the other day, which was a conference down in San Francisco, that talked about the Dogecoin tip bot versus the Reddit versus the Bitcoin tip bot. The Bitcoin tip bot's been in process and working. You know, I think it was delivered 27,000 tips or something like that for about a year now. And the average tip is about $7, and I don't remember what the total was. But the relevant part was is that in the 3 months that Doge TipBot has been around, their average tip has been 26 cents, but they've done several times the amount of total volume and hundreds of thousands of tipping transactions. So even though rationally as humans we know that numbers don't matter, especially when it comes to things like Bitcoin that are divisible down to 8 decimal places. And so, I mean, again, you can think of a Satoshi as a real true, that is the singular unit of a Bitcoin. And a Bitcoin itself is 100 million Satoshis, or is it 100 billion? 100 million, thank you. Yeah, so with Doge, again, all you're doing is moving the decimal point. Every block is, you know, is 25,000 instead of 25. But does that really matter? I think that in practice it does. It means that people are more willing to give them up because they feel like they have more of them. So LTB coin is mining recast as content creation, is recast as audience participation, recast as things that add value to a content network. And, you know, I mean, like, real quickly, we're doing a lot of different proofs of work. This is, again, I think what we're going to see over the next year is the liberalization of the term proof of work. It's going to become something that describes any action that can be rewarded using these systems. And so we're doing proof of commenting, proof of tipping, proof of, again, it's going to be some sort of conglomerated share metric. We're doing proof of value, which is to say that if somebody tips your... basically, it's all about making things competitive, right? Because if you set, if you say, oh, well, this is the correct number that you need to be at in order to do this whatever thing, what if nobody reaches it in that week? You know, I mean, you have to make it a competition. And so by doing that, essentially, we have 5 shows on our network. We're expanding out to 11. These are all on Bitcoin content because that's where we're starting, but we're going more from there. All of these shows will essentially receive one flat payment when they successfully publish an episode that is in new coins. So again, just like the miners in the Bitcoin situation, by adding value to Bitcoin, they are rewarded with these new tokens. In the same way here, we do the same thing to audience and to content creators. So anyways, there's more to this, but the reality of it is that I think this is going to be a reinvention of the Huffington Post model. The Huffington Post has 7,000 bloggers, they censor them, they don't pay them, and they feature the ones that get the most page views. We're basically going to take that, we're not going to censor them, we're going to pay the ones that provide the most value to the network in the currency of the network, and we're going to, you know, feature them. That is basically the thing. But that's the point, is that starting from a self-bootstrapping point of view, how do you go from the nothing to the something that people want to be a part of? I think that these technologies over the next few months are really going to solve this problem. So thank you very much for your time.